Eventually, I started seeing more musicians referencing the band. And
yeah, the do-it-yourself mentality is still proves itself today. I think yeah. With the latest album you had.
Yeah, we did it ourselves. Yeah.
To prove the points in that matter. Yeah, of course you did the records back in the 70s were very competitive.
Seems like the 60s.
But now there's obviously bigger gaps between the records now. At what point for the latest album, at what point do you think, well, it's time now to do a new album?
Well,
are you constantly writing?
I had two kids, so it took a long time to get them going. I spent a lot of time doing my dad routine, you know.
Do they know what that was?
Yeah, now they're here. Yeah, they're on tour with us. So. Yeah, they sort of got the idea.
But I try to get them to take over for the drums, but they don't want to do it.
Not yet.
Maybe in a few years, maybe.
But is Blondie a thing that always has been alive in your head that you wanted to continue with, or did you at some point maybe think that
I always had in the back of my head that we should reform over the whatever 16 years when the group stopped after the 80s. I always had, but eventually I started seeing more musicians referencing the band and people referencing the band out there in the world, you know.
The album we made in the late 90s, No Exit, aside from it being a Sartre book, it refers to No Exit really, but No Escape from
You're bound to do
Blondie, whatever that may be. And it's also kind of like we're living on the other side of the dream now. You know, the dream was to be a success. The dream was to have hit records. The dream was to go on tour. And then all that sort of just ended. We became fully formed adults. And now kind of like the next part, it's not really the dream now, it's the reality. This is what we do, you know? And so it was always there. I always thought perhaps someday, I had a friend called by the name of Sheldon who always told me he thought that one day we would reform, and he would always kind of prompt me on that. And I had a feeling that perhaps someday we would, but there's no escaping it. I mean, it's part of-
Is that a pressure or is that a good thing?
No, it's great.
It just seemed like the moment was right. And also, you know, F. Scott Fitzgerald said there's no second act in American life. We have had a second act.
Okay. There were 34 songs written for this album, if I'm correct.
Well, I don't know.
That,
I have no idea.
We recorded a lot of stuff.
We were always recording. Because it's so easy to record now. You just press the button and stuff is recorded. So there was a lot of stuff recorded. I think fully formed, there's maybe 17, 18 songs. I'm not sure. So they'll all get out
eventually. We did a lot of drum tracks, a lot of basic tracks that weren't completely done. We might get back to.
Yeah.
It would be nice to have an outtake record someday.
We did a version of Rock On, you know? The Essex
David
song.
Essex.
Yeah, so, but I don't know what's going on. We never even worked on it too much.
I was just, already to round up, but what's your favorite lyric of the album written by...
Now, I really love the, do you want some more debris line. It's great.
What's that in?
In D-Day.
Oh, in D-Day.
That's a
Can
great
line. Can you
describe
a little bit what's struck something in you?
That is just so fucking funny, you know? It's just crazy, you know? It's because the song is about invasion and war, and also about Debbie. So,
in what way do you can you tell by just reading her lyrics what she was going through when she wrote it?
No, not necessarily. I don't know if
only
I can,
she knows.
Yeah,
for sure.
I don't know if I could go that far, but I sort of know what she means. I get most of her jokes.
Does she talk with you about it? Does she talk?
Oh yeah, sure, at length. Yeah, we're always going over lyrics. We're behind on lyrics now for the next record. I have a lot of tracks finished and not a lot of lyrics yet. So waiting on stuff.
So you already said it a little bit, there will be a next album?
Oh yeah, we're well into it now, yeah.
Yeah?
We'd like to do a covers record too.
Yeah, I think we'll keep going. I mean, recording is, you know, a lot easier than touring nowadays, so we'll definitely keep, I really would like to keep doing recorded music as long as possible.
But did the gap, your job as a father, you have to find the balance now between being a good father and recording
Well, now artists. That the kids are older, it's easier to go off by myself and sit there and do the stuff. You know, I just work with the computers now and record, so.
Final question. Who came up with the title for this record?
It was kind of me. There was a line in a song that, it was a song called The End of the World, and there was a line that was after it that said the panic of truth, And I said, no, it should rhyme with world. Says, let's just make it girls. And then that was it. Really, there's not a lot of pre-thought in all this stuff. It just goes. We just go forwards, and whatever feels right is what happens.
And is there thought after it, or?
The thought. Well, most art is analyzed after the fact. You know, like the Velvet Underground. Everybody reads all kinds of stuff into that. Those guys were just doing it and doing poetry that they thought was meaningful to them. But I don't think they were thinking on as many levels as what is written into their material now by people who are observing it.
Yeah, it's meant to be interpreted after the fact.
Paintings. I mean, you look at I don't think Van Gogh, when he painted the crows in the cornfield, was thinking about his death and that they meant that.
When you get someone like Dylan, it's like almost every line of his song could be another song, so you could go off on a different thought process, So there's a lot of abstraction involved in the creative process in general, I think. If it wasn't, it would be much more technical to the point of analytically being sort of not art,
We'll leave that to the listeners then.
Peace and love to everyone out there.
Thank you for your time.